God bless you today. This is Pastor Durham with the Better Way Apostolic Church, and we are so delighted to be with you again. I hope and trust that you are being blessed by the Word of God as we continue our study from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 14 on tonight. Now, before we get into the Word of God, let's have a word of prayer. So many things to pray for, all of the unrest that is going on in the Middle East, the coronavirus in India and other parts of the world, the decrease, and we thank God for that here in the U.S., but we want to continue to pray for the lost souls also that don't know Christ, and pray for every believer that we stay encouraged in the Lord. Now, I don't know if you realize this or not. Some at the beginning of the pandemic were panicking, not knowing how they were going to make it, how they were going to survive. But the Lord brought it to my attention. Almost a year and some months has passed by, and yet God has sustained us. So take a moment and reflect on that. That even though there was a lot of uncertainty, the reality is that God has still kept us and is keeping us even today. So, Father, we bless and we thank you even now for being such an awesome God. We pray that you would speak to the hearts of your people. We pray, God, Lord, that you would continue to lead and guide and order the steps of every leader. Lord, those in the White House, the State House, and the Church House. And God, even in our very own houses on today. We pray, God, that as we look into your word, that you would give us an inspiring word, Lord, that would speak to the heart of your people. We bless and we thank you for it all in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, it is certainly a privilege and an honor to come before you each week. And for those who are responding to the word and leaving your comments, I just want to tell you thank you. It's not something that we take lightly. There is always some encouraging words for you and I in the Word of God. And so let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And our reading will begin with verse number 1. In this 14th chapter, Paul talks about that all of the gifts, should be desired. But he says especially the gift of prophecy. So 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse number 1, Paul starts out by saying to us that follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit in the spirit he speaketh mysteries. But he that prophesies speaketh unto men to edification and exhortation and comfort. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself, but he that prophesied edified the church. I would that you all speak with tongues, but rather that you prophesy. For greater is he that prophesied than he which he that speaketh with tongues, except he interpret that the church may receive edifying. All right, so tonight we want to talk to you about being wise about using spiritual gifts. Now, Paul had discussed the gifts of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit and the grace of the Spirit. And now he concludes in this section by explaining the government of the Spirit in the public worship service of the church. Now, apparently, there was a tendency for some of the Corinthians to lose control of themselves as they exercised their gifts. And Paul had to remind them of the fundamental principle that ought to govern the public meetings of the church. And so there are three principles. First, Paul talks about the edification. Then he talks about the understanding. And then he talks about the order. Now, I want to say from the outset, when Paul talks about the tongues and the interpretation, he's not referring to the sign that you have received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Now, in Acts chapter 2 and verse 4, it says, "And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit of God gave them the utterance." And so that's different from tongues and interpretation. Now, it also tells us that when we speak in tongues and there is no interpretation, we are edifying ourselves. So Paul talks about this edification, and this was one of Paul's favorite words, borrowed, of course, from the architect. To edify means to build up. And so you and I have a responsibility as believers to build up our brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, the concept is not alien to the body image of the church. Even today, we speak about bodybuilding exercises. And so there is an overlapping of images here, for the body of Christ is also the temple of the living God. Now, Paul's choice of words, edify, was a wise one. And I said was wise because when we realize that our responsibility is to build up one another, you know, there are no big I's and little U's in the kingdom of God. Everybody is somebody. And so the mistake the Corinthians were making was to emphasize their own personal edification to the neglect of the church. They wanted to build themselves up, but they did not want to build up their fellow believers. Well, this attitude, of course, not only hurt the other Christians, but it also hurt the believers who were practicing it. After all, if we are all members of the same body, the way we relate to the other members must ultimately affect us personally. So the eye cannot say to the hand, "I have no need of thee," according to 1 Corinthians 12 and 21. If one member of the body is weak or infected, it will affect the other members of the body. Now, many times I think all of us can relate to this, that if we are sick in our bodies, then it affects the whole body. The mind may say get up, but the body is not feeling it because the sickness has affected the whole body. And so Paul detected that the church was neglecting prophecy and giving a wrong emphasis to tongues. Now, we must not think of the New Testament prophets as a person who foretold the future, for even the Old Testament prophets did more than that. Prophets received God's message immediately through the Holy Spirit and communicated that message to the church.
usually in tongues, but not always. And so prophecy was not the same as our modern day preaching, because today preachers study the Bible and prepare their message. No preacher today should claim that he has everything, but God does still give us an inspiring word. Some preachers would say that I just got an SOS. In other words, God has dropped something in your spirit, because God knows what His church needs. He knows what His children needs, and so sometimes people will say, it's like you are, you know, have been in my house, or you've been in my mind. No, that's God speaking a word, a fresh word to you. And so when we're not selfish with the gifts that God give us, then the gifts bless and edify and build up the whole body of Christ. And so Paul explains the supreme value of prophecy over tongues by contrasting the two gifts. And so Paul says prophecy speaks to men, but tongues speak to God. Oh, what a powerful word that Paul is telling us. And so we refer back to Acts chapter 2 and verse 4, that when we speak in tongues, we are talking to God. When we know that the Spirit of God lives in us, when God has deposited His Spirit in us, then we will speak in tongues as the Spirit of God gives the utterance. Now sometimes we get it mixed up, we get it confused, because we may feel the Spirit, but I'm talking about the Spirit living, dwelling in you on a permanent basis. That's the gift that God wants to give you. Now, some have said that it's done away with, but God is still filling individuals today with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And can I tell you that if you're watching this telecast tonight, God is speaking to you. He wants to deposit the Spirit in you and not just around you. Well, let me give you a visual image that oftentimes when we look at a fireplace, we can feel the warmth of the fireplace, but the fire is not in us. Well, oftentimes we feel the Spirit of God, but the Spirit of God is not in us. Well, God has made it possible for you to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. Now, I invite you to call us, to comment, or better yet, come and be with us in one of our live services here, and we'll be glad to sit down with you and show you that this is a gift that God wants to give you. It is a privilege and an honor to have the indwelling Spirit live in you. Now, if you are zealous for spiritual gifts, at least desire the best gift, was Paul's, counsel. He said, prophecy was best because it builds up the church. It gave the listeners encouragement and comfort, something that everybody needs. I don't care how long you've been in the faith, you need to be encouraged. Because life gets in the way. Life tries to pull us down, to knock us down, to turn us around. But I encourage you today to hold fast, to stand fast, and to know that God is on your side. Now it is unfortunate that our translations insert the word unknown in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and 2, because the New Testament knows nothing of an unknown tongue. From the very beginning of the church, tongues was known as a language recognized by the believers. Now, the tongue would be unknown to the speaker and to the listener, but it was not unknown to the world. Now, let me tell you how awesome God is. Now, God is so awesome that on the day of Pentecost, that when the Holy Ghost came pouring down as a rushing mighty wind, they were all speaking in tongues. Now, they didn't understand, but God had it so that everybody could understand them because it was a sign. And they said they must be drunk. And Peter stood up and says that it's only the third hour of the day. We are not drunk. He said, but this is that was prophesied, that in the last days that God was going to pour out his spirit. And that's what God is doing even now. He is pouring out his spirit. And I don't know about you, but I want everything that God has available to me. So while it is unfortunate that people have that idea that tongues was used to preach the gospel to the lost, quite the contrary was true. Paul was afraid that the excessive tongue speaking in church would convince the lost that the Christians were crazy. So here it is. Can you imagine you come into a church service? Because they were zealous. They were going overboard. Everybody was just speaking in tongues. And then if you see you come into a church and you're not understanding what the people are saying, yes, you're going to think that they're crazy. You know, because they're not talking in your language. Remember, we said from the outset that when we speak in tongues, that we're talking to God. And so Paul says that prophecy would be a better gift because the prophecy helps to build up and to comfort each believer as well as the unbeliever. But the sign that God is living in you, you will speak in tongues as the Spirit of God gives the utterance. Now, if you examine the book of Acts, you will find countless scriptures that when they were filled with the Spirit of God, they spoke in tongues. Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 8, Acts chapter 10, and Acts chapter 19. The time's not going to allow us to examine all of those today, but I want to stir up your curiosity. I want to let you know that God has a whole lot more for you in the kingdom of God. Yes, God's talking to you. It's not an accident that you're viewing this telecast tonight. You have said that you want more of God. There's got to be a better way. There's something missing in my life. You have the money, you have the degrees, you have a nice house, you have a nice family, but there's still something missing. Can I tell you that it is the Spirit of God living in you? Because there's a void that only God can fill. Allow God to fill that void in your life today. Now, the Bible lets us know that in 1 Corinthians 14 and 23, that at Pentecost, the believers extolled the wonderful work of God, but Peter preached the gospel in the Aramaic language his listeners could understand. Now, the believer who speaks in a tongue speaks to God in praise and worship, but the believer who prophesies shares the word with the church and helps those who are listening. This leads to the second contrast. Now, and so Paul says that prophecy edifies the church, tongues edify only the speaker. Paul did not deny the value of the speaker speaking in tongues, but he did place a greater value on building up the church. So greater is he that prophesied than he that speaketh with tongues. Again, we're referring to tongues, and if you're just speaking in tongues and there's no interpretation, Paul says that's not benefiting the whole. That's just benefiting you. Unless the tongues are interpreted according to 1 Corinthians 12, verses 10 and verse 30, the message can do the church no good. And so Paul points out that an interpreter must be present before the gifts of tongues may be exercised. So please take a moment and digest the gift of tongues that Paul is talking about here, and the speaking in tongues as the initial sign that God is in your life. Now keep in mind that the members of the Corinthian church did not sit in the service with the Bibles on their laptop. The New Testament church was being written, and the Old Testament scrolls were expensive and not available to most believers. And so God spoke to his people directly through the prophets, and the message was sometimes given in a tongue. And now the three gifts of knowledge, prophecy, and tongues work together to convey the truth to the people of God. And so Paul emphasizes the importance of the doctrinal teachings in the church. Our worship must be based on the truth, or it may become superstitious and emotionalism. Christians need to know why they believe and what they believe. And so the prophets shared truth with the church and thereby edified the assembly. Now, the person speaking in tongues, unless there is an interpretation, is enjoying his worship of God, but he is not edifying the church. Now, I want to bring out this powerful point again. I may have mentioned it before, but I believe it's worth mentioning again, that in the book of Numbers, when God was leading the children of Israel through the desert, it was a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day. And when he chose a place that they could set the tabernacle, the Bible says that as they placed it, the presence of the Lord, it came up. And as the presence of the Lord came up, the enemies were scattered. And so I want to let you know that there's power in your worship and your praise to God. That as you invite the presence of God in your life and in your situation, what he says to you is that I'm going to scatter your enemies. Every enemy that's on your back, begin to worship and to praise God. And watch God, amen, take that enemy out of your presence. Oh, that's a powerful nugget that you need to hold on to, because the battle is not yours, it's the Lord's. And so Paul was emphasizing the importance of this. Now, in my own ministry, I have shared in many local church services and conferences, and I have always tried to communicate biblical truth to the people. Now, sometimes the music has not been edifying, and at other times, the music communicated the word of God in a powerful way. Whenever all of our, all of us as ministers have aimed to edify and not to entertain, God has blessed the people and they have been helped. And so a ministry that does not build up will tear down, no matter how spiritual it may seem. And so it's important for us to encourage our brothers and sisters in Christ. And so when we explain and apply the word of God to individuals' lives, then we have a ministry of edification. And that's simply what Paul was trying to tell us today in our lesson, that we have a responsibility to encourage our brothers and sisters in Christ. It doesn't matter how long you've been in the body of Christ. Everybody needs to be encouraged. Everybody needs to know that even though I'm going through, that God can bring me out. And so I encourage you today that if you have not received Bible salvation according to the word of God, this is your day, it's your opportunity. It's not an accident that you clicked on. I want to encourage you that every time you watch our service to click and share, because I believe that God wants us to help expand the kingdom of God. And you can help us grow the kingdom of God by simply clicking and sharing. Because the word of God needs to reach everybody. God has given us this tool called social media to do just that. And so today, I invite you, according to the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 37, Peter said to them to repent of your sins, be baptized in water in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission and the removal of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, if you've been blessed by this service and you'd like to share or be with us in one of our live services, I invite you to come every Sunday morning at 11 a.m. God bless you as our prayer until we meet again in Jesus' name.